Yo, what's up my guys? Now, this video is a really interesting one and it should help some of you guys who struggle with fault finding and determining the correct fault with amplifiers that have strange problems. Not your generic blown FETs or, you know, smoked up power supply FETs, etc. This is an interesting one and it took me a few sort of attempts to locate where the fault was until I finally found it. This is a Sundown SAZ1500D. It's one of the newer ones, I believe. I'll go through exactly what components are on the board in just a moment. But this methodology here and this video should help you when you're working on any type of amplifier. It's just about the thought process of going through and finding where the fault comes from. So this amplifier was sent in and the issue, as the customer stated, was it powered up just fine. I had a blue light and everything like that. It wasn't smoking or anything. There was no dead FETs that you could see. But there was no sound output. It wasn't actually outputting any sound whatsoever. So the first thing that any tech will do when you get an amplifier in like this, that the customer says it turns on just fine, is to power it up yourself, and with your oscilloscope probe, is to read some of the waves coming off the board to try and determine what is going on here. So let's power it up. I'm going to probe the drain pin of the power supply FET here, which should have the power supply voltage on it, in this case 10 volts DC. And when we hit the remote, we should see the power supply switch, the push-pull square wave on the output of the MOSFET here. So let's have a look, see whether that's there. Yep, okay, so we have a square wave on the output of the power supply MOSFETs. So that means that the power supply is working fine. That looks pretty nice. So that means that we should be building the rail voltages, and the rail voltages will be present on the rectifiers here. These are the rectifier diodes that turn that great big AC wave coming off the transformer into the high voltage rail and the low voltage rail, as you can see there. And the other side over here, this will be the high voltage rail. Yeah, so that's working fine. The power supply is working fine and it's building the rail voltages correctly. Cool, so that's one thing out of the way. Power supply seems to be fine. The output section is the next thing that we want to check. So the guy said that it was producing no sound. That could be a pretty simple fault, maybe with the preamp section. That's the first thing that you might think, is that the sine wave is not making its way to the amplifier section. But it could also be that the output section isn't actually working, even though we have a blue light. The blue light doesn't mean the output section is working. So first of all, let's check which side is high side and which side is low side. That's how these amplifiers work. Class D, we have a high side FETs and low side FETs. So the high side FETs are these four, and we can tell that because we have the positive rail on the back of these FETs. Pin number two, as you can see there, we have the positive rail on the back of these FETs, meaning that the low side FETs are these ones, which have the negative rail voltage on pin number three, which is correct. Now, if the output section was working correctly, on pin number two, the back of the low side FETs, we should have a big square wave that switches between positive rail and negative rail. So let's check that. Ah, there's nothing there at all. On the high side FETs, we should have a big square wave that oscillates between rail on pins one and three. So let's check that. Nothing there either. So the problem then is that the output section isn't switching. It's not activated. The amplifier isn't running. Even though we have a blue light, everything appears to be fine. The output section isn't running. So whatever is the problem, the reason that it's not running is because the drive circuit, in this case this driver board here, isn't sending the pulses to the gates of the MOSFETs. And there can be a number of reasons for that. Sometimes these amplifiers won't start building the Class D square wave without running some kind of RCA signal just to kick start the amplifier into operation. So I tried that. I ran some RCA signal, some 40 hertz into the RCAs. Sometimes that kicks it into life, but it didn't. So that means that we do have some problem that's preventing the pulses getting to the MOSFETs. Now, my initial thought was, okay, there's two faults that are, you know, pretty common that could be causing this issue. The first cause is that the driver board isn't receiving the correct power supply voltages, the VCC. These are low voltage power supplies for the chips to work on. So the chip, that basically means the chips won't be getting their power, which means they won't be doing their job, hence why the amplifier doesn't work. The second fault could be that this is the drive chip here. This is an IR2113S. Excuse my phone making all sorts of noises. So this chip here is the drive chip. This is what's going to be driving the MOSFETs. And it's buffered through these transistors here. We've got two transistors there and two transistors there, NPN and PNP. These just buffer the drive IC. Just give it a bit more oomph. So it goes from the drive IC to the buffer transistors to the MOSFET gates. So for some reason, Oh man, everyone's talking to me today. For some reason, there are no pulses being sent from the chip through the drive transistors to the gates, to the MOSFET gates. So the first thing that I checked, I won't actually do these probe tests with one hand because if I slip my oscilloscope probe and short out some pins, it causes more damage. But what I did is I had a look at what was on some of these pins of this drive chip, of this IC here. If we go ahead and have a look at the data sheet for this chip, we're looking at this top right hand corner one, the 16 lead SOIC, which is the 2113S. As we can see here, there are some pins labeled here, and the important ones to see whether this chip is getting power is VCC and VDD. I probed VDD here, which had the correct voltage on it. I couldn't probe VCC because it was a little bit too far under there. I didn't want to try and get my probe in there and short something out that would cause more damage. So VCC is potentially a problem, but I was unable to check it at this time. I just wanted to do some quick checks. The next thing that I wanted to check was whether this chip was actually being fed with the logic signal from the PWM generation circuit, or the, you know, the Class D generation circuit. So that would be on H in and L in. That's literally just high input and low input. High side input, low side input, and that's the logic. So on these pins, we should see a little small square wave, which is the logic, the pulses, coming from the generation circuit. And if you feed the amplifier with some signal, like 40 Hz, then if everything is working correctly up to this point, we should see a 40 Hz small square wave on H in and a small 40 Hz square wave on L in. Which I did. I did actually see the correct logic signal coming in to H in and L in, which meant that this chip here was being fed with the correct logic to start the amplifier working. That also meant that the Class D pulse generation circuit, which is something to do with these chips over here, is working correctly. And it also means that these chips are being fed with the correct VCC, the correct power supply voltages in order to work, because otherwise we wouldn't get any logic input to this chip here. So that was working fine. So the fault now is either with whatever is providing the IR2113S with VCC, or with the IRS 1213 blah, 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 with this chip itself. There might be a problem with this chip itself. So in order to determine which one of those it was, I started looking at the components on the board that generate the low voltage VCCs that actually run the chips that give them power. Over here, we can see that we have a couple of what look like transistors, but they're not. These are voltage regulators, and these are labeled Kia 7815 and 7915. So these are the things that generate the plus and minus 15 volts, and these things power many chips, including the op amps in the preamp section over here, and the chips on the PWM, the Class D generation circuit over here. So those are probably working fine because we had the logic input. We can check that just by going over here, turning the amplifier on. We're going to be measuring to make sure that we have the correct voltage on here. So we go to the output of the 7815. Yep, we've got 15 volts on the output of the 7815. And on the 7915, we have negative, let's have a look. Yeah, negative 15 volts. So we've got plus 15 volts and negative 15 volts on these voltage regulators. So these are working fine, and we can make sure that they actually make their way to where they're supposed to on the board by just checking those again over here on the op amps for the preamp circuit. So let's check that over here. We should have on pins 4 and 8, we should have those voltages. Plus 15, yep, that's correct on number 8, and on number 4 we should have negative 15. Yeah, that's correct. So these ones are working fine. The other voltage that this drive circuit, drive board needs in order to work properly is the VCC for this 2113S. And that is going to be 12 volts above negative rail. So this chip, it actually works on, it takes its ground as the negative rail, and its VCC should be 12 volts above negative rail. So in order to read that correctly on our scope, what I'm going to do is I'm going to decouple the ground from my power supply, and I'm going to take my scope's ground, I'm going to clip that onto the negative rail. So basically what my scope sees as ground is now going to be negative rail. And the negative rail is just on this set of resistors here. These are current current draw resistors. These are actually the resistors that sense over current protection. That's to do with that. But this has a negative rail on it, so that's very useful. So the 12 volt regulator is this little bad boy here. See this? If I bend that, I'm not going to bend it too much, I don't want to snap the pins off. But this thing is labeled up as, if we can maybe see in there, it's got some glue on it, but this is a 78T12. So a bit like the 7815, this is a 7812. So this is a 12 volt regulator. So what we want to do is make sure that this has 12 volts on its output. So if we go ahead and look at the data sheet of this, just to confirm which pin is output, we can see here this is a 78TXX, meaning the 78T12 will be included in this data sheet. So pin number 1 is input, pin number 2 is ground, and pin number 3 is output. So ground should be negative rail, input should be about 20 volts above negative rail, and output should be 12 volts above negative rail. That's how this works. The input is fed with more than 12 volts, and then this regulates the, I don't know, about 20 volts down to 12 volts. It means that no matter what the input voltage to the amplifier is, no matter what the rail voltage is, even if this thing is ran at 9 volts or 15 volts, that 12 volts is still the same. It's not going to give too much voltage to the ICs. It's just a kind of constant voltage supply for the ICs, regardless of what the rail voltage is. So if we take our oscilloscope probe and we have our ground on the negative rail, let's go ahead and see what we've got on this voltage regulator with the amplifier powered up. We're going to turn the scope down a little bit so we can zoom in a bit more on these voltages. I'm going to go for 5 volts divide, so that means 5 volts divide. Each little line on the screen here is 5 volts. So we've got 5, 10, 15, 20. So the top here is 20. So we should see, up at the top here, that should be the input, and then the regulated output should be 5, 10, should be somewhere around here. Let's take our probe once more, turn the amplifier on, and we are wanting to probe, first of all, the ground, pin number 2, just the back of this, to make sure that it's pretty much on zero. So if I go ahead and probe this, you can see there that the line doesn't move on the scope, so that's correct, that is ground, there's nothing there. If we now probe the input, we should have something above 12 volts on here. Ah, we actually only have 1 volt, so This regulator isn't being fed with the correct input voltage, which also means that on pin number 3, being the output, we also don't have anything. We've got about one volt again there as well. So whatever is supplying this regulator with its voltages, with its power, is not working. It's not getting there. It's not correct. So what we need to do to troubleshoot to find where the problem is on that one is we need to trace where the input of this regulator comes from. Now, if you look closely, you can just about see on the board here the trace that feeds pin number 1. It comes from here, goes along here, underneath these diodes, the rectifier diodes, and it goes to these vias here on the board. And if we flip the board over, which I'm not going to do now, these traces continue under the board, and they end up on these small transformer winds here. So this is the power supply transformer, and off the power supply transformer there is a couple of really small winds that feed this voltage regulator with about 20 volts above negative rail for it then to regulate down to 12 volts. So on here we should see a square wave that is mimicking what the power supply FETs are giving it, the same frequency, but just a little bit above negative rail. So this is strange, this should be working fine. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to power the amplifier up and just check to see whether there is a square wave on that. So fortunately there's a little bit of exposed metal here, so I can go ahead and probe. Ah, look, yes, there is a big square wave on that that's going up to about just under 20 volts and down to negative 20 volts. So that looks about right, that's kind of what we're looking for here. And on the other one, and if I go ahead and probe the other pin coming off there, there's a little bit of square wave noise, but that's basically ground. So we have the square wave there that should be rectified and then can feed the 12 volt regulator, and on the other side we should have nothing. Okay, cool. So the transformer is doing its job and we have the nice big square wave there. So the transformer is working fine, doesn't look like there's a shorted wind or anything in there. Now these leads are connected directly to these pads here, these vias. There's no other components in between this trace and this transformer, which means that we should have the square wave on one of these pads. We have a really small version of it, 1 volt version of it, and on the other one, we have nothing. So somewhere between that lead on the transformer and this pad, there appears to be a break or a high resistance that's preventing that nice big sort of 18 volt plus minus square wave from the output of the transformer making its way along the trace to this regulation circuit here. So, as a result, I concur, that there is more than likely a snapped lead under this glue here on this transformer that's preventing that nice big square wave that's on this transformer leg from actually making its way onto the trace. There's probably a break in this copper wire here underneath this glue. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to pull this glue off, I'm going to desolder this leg and just to see whether there is actually a snap under there or whether there's a bad solder connection or something that's preventing the voltage getting along the trace. Now, if there is a break in one of those leads, when I desolder from the bottom here, there'll be the little bit that's left of the copper wire should just pull out. So let's see if it's this one. Aha, look, there we go. What did I say? That's the problem then. So that's obviously still glued to the top of the board, and this is the lead that snapped. So the other half of that is still on the transformer, and that is why we weren't getting the input to the 7812. Let's just check to see whether the other one is snapped as well. Nope, see how that's still attached to the wind? So that one hasn't snapped, but it was that one that had snapped, preventing that 7812 from getting its input. So I'm going to take my solder sucker, and I'm just going to suck. I don't know if I'll be able to suck the solder out of this because there might not be any air path flow from the other side. Oh, there is a little bit. There we go. So now, so you can see there, that's the other part of the lead that had snapped. So very simple fix, really. All you need to do is push that down through the hole and re-solder. There we go, so that snap lead, I've just pushed that down through the hole a little bit more. So let's solder that up, flip it back over, power it up, and see if that's resolved the problem. Resoldered, and power time now. Now when I power it up, I'm going to probe the low side drain. That's indication, if we get a square wave on there, that everything is most likely working correctly. So let's power her up and see if we get the Class D switch on low side drain. There's still nothing there. So because there was still nothing there, I'm going to go ahead and probe the output of this 12 volt regulator to see whether the regulator was damaged in whatever happened. Maybe this snapped and it drew current, and maybe this got damaged by some strange anomaly. So I'm going to go ahead and probe the output, but to do that I need to decouple my my ground again, just not play the music, and let's probe the negative rail with the ground and clip that onto my probe. Not ideal doing this one-handed. And turn the scope back down to 5 volts divide. Okay, so we should now have that square wave appearing on these little vias where we didn't have it before. So let's power this up. There we go, so we've got the square wave on the via now where it should be. So if I go ahead and probe the 12 volt regulator, ground is still nothing, which it should be. The inputs to this should be, there we go, we've got 12 volts worth of inputs to the regulator, and on the output we also have voltage on the output. I think actually I've got this, yeah, because I'm looking at this backwards. So actually this pin here, this pin is at 14.2 volts and this pin here is at 12.28 volts. So this is the output pin here. So why is the amplifier now still not working? Possibly we need to kickstart it, like I said before, with some sine wave into the input. So I'm going to go ahead and play some music and plug the RCAs in and see whether that kicks it into operation. So just before I do that, I'm going to crank the voltage input up a little bit, just to 12 volts, because sometimes these Class D circuits, without any speaker on the speaker terminals and without any RCA input, the Class D circuit, it doesn't come into operation. And sometimes, especially on a low voltage, that is emphasized. So I'm going to crank it up to 12 volts and just see whether that changes anything on the low side drain. Nope, still nothing there. Next thing to try to kick it into operation, sometimes these amplifiers, they need a speaker or some load on the speaker terminals in order for the feedback loop to complete and it to start to oscillate. So let's go ahead and put a low value resistor that across the speaker terminals here. So let's see if that makes a difference. Nope, still nothing there. So the last thing to try then is remove the resistor, because we don't want the resistor to get any power from when the audio starts coming. Let's take some RCAs, plug them in here. And let's see whether feeding it with a signal causes it to work. Let's put some music, whatever I was listening to. I'm okay to carry round a knife. So when did it become okay to take somebody's life? So please tell me what was going through your mind when you left your consciousness behind. There we go, that started to look like it was gonna try and work. So let's turn that back. Let's turn that up a little bit so we can see it a little bit better on the screen. Turn that down, back down to a low voltage in case it's not happy for whatever reason. Now I'm gonna monitor, whilst that was trying to build the Class D switch wave, I'm gonna monitor the current draw, because if there's still a fault with the output section that's preventing that from building correctly, then that could draw excessive current. So I'm going to just go ahead and do that, probe that one more time. I'm going to monitor the current draw on this whilst it's trying to build that wave. Play the music back. Before you do your caring families apart, it's never too late to quit and have a fresh start. Educate yourself because your actions have a price. So I'm begging all the youth, drop the knife and value life. One bad decision, it can change your life forever. It's trying to build, and we don't have much current draw there at all, so I don't think there's a problem with the output section. Let's just check the heat on the FETs. I'm going to actually stop the music. I'm going to play a sine wave instead. It's a little bit more constant. Let's go ahead and open Audacity on the screen here. And let's go and generate a 40 hertz test tone. And let's hit go on that. So we have a 40 hertz test tone coming into the amplifier now. Let's see if that makes any difference. And at the same time, I haven't got enough hands for this, so I'm going to take my thermal imaging camera and just keep an eye on the heat of these FETs as they're trying to turn on. Because we obviously had some vibration damage that caused a broken lead on this transformer, it's also possible that maybe the inductors have a snapped lead as well. That would also prevent the Class D switch wave from building properly. So I'm going to check that out. If this doesn't work, I'm going to check that out in a minute as well. I'm just going to keep an eye on the temperature of these FETs as I'm testing this. So let's go ahead and switch it back on. Oh, it's trying very, very hard. It's not able to maintain that Class D switch. So that means that the chip is now working, but there's something preventing the feedback loop from being completed. So I'm going to go and probe the high side gate and see whether that's actually giving that FET. Yeah, it is making its way to that FET. So something's not right with the feedback loop, preventing that from actually building and staying on. Thermal imaging camera. The FETs aren't getting warm. We've got one resistor getting warm there, which is just a rail resistor that's designed to get hot. That's fine. So I don't think there's a problem with the FETs or anything there that's preventing that from happening. So, but yeah, it won't hold the switching on. So I'm going to go ahead now and do the same check that I did with these leads. Make sure that the inductors are actually connected to the board properly. Flip her over and do a continuity test with the multimeter, and also check the inductance with my inductance meter, which is this baby here. I discovered something else here. Now, I noticed this before, but I assumed it had been done correctly, but maybe not. See this capacitor here? This has obviously been repaired at some point in the past. We've got a jump lead coming off this capacitor going to negative rail, being its ground, and then the positive one, this trace looks a little bit damaged, like it's been lifted or something in the past. So I was kind of probing and messing around with this capacitor while the amplifier was on, and it actually affects it. So what I'm going to do is show you here. I've got the probe on the low side drain. Now these amplifiers, I've noticed before, these do require some kind of kickstart to get the thing running from the RCAs. So when you first power this amplifier up, even with a load attached, the Class D switch might not build yet, only when it receives some tiny, it only requires the tiniest little bit of RCA signal, and then the amplifier kicks into operation and stays working. Now if I go ahead and power the amplifier up, first of all. So we've got power into the amplifier, as you see, 0.1 amp there, and obviously there's nothing on the screen here. If I try and play the RCA to kickstart it into operation, it's all fucking around, it's not very nice, there's no decent sine wave there going on. However, if I do this, and then touch this capacitor here, suddenly it works. However, if I release the pressure from the capacitor, it goes funky again. So I'm just going to go ahead and just, whilst I've got my hand on the cap, pause the signal there. And now you can see that the Class D switch is built and working perfectly. However, if I remove the pressure from this capacitor, just on its side here, you can see how it all goes wrong. The switch wave is the completely wrong frequency and it doesn't like it. So that is the problem. We obviously have a dodgy connection on this capacitor that wasn't soldered properly. So I'm going to go ahead and remove that and re-solder it correctly. Nice strong connections to wherever it needs to go, and that should fix it. So this here is our problem. Whoever replaced the cap before didn't solder it correctly so that the veer at the top was actually connecting properly to the capacitor. Obviously they've soldered it from the bottom, so you've got the bottom trace veer is connected to the cap. However, on the top, this is lacking solder, so therefore this trace here that has obviously been lifted at some point isn't actually connected to the cap, so that just needs soldering properly and it should work. Now that joint's been fixed, I'm just curious to see whether it will actually turn on and build the Class D wave without any RCA help. So because it was giving a little pulse occasionally when I turned it on without the RCAs in, and obviously didn't build properly because that capacitor wasn't soldered correctly. Let's just see. Okay, so we got a little, you see it just on the screen a minute ago, we just saw just a tiny little, yeah, it's doing a little something. So let's give the RCAs back in and kickstart it into operation. There we go, perfect. So it just needs a teeny tiny little bit of RCA signal in order to build the output Class D switch wave, and then it works perfectly fine. So let's go off and go back on again. And then just give it a tiny little bit of signal. This is very, very low input voltage. The gain is on zero, and we've got the computer volume turned right down. So it's literally a couple of millivolts worth of signal here that just kicks that into operation. And that's actually quite typical of how these style of Class D amplifiers actually behave. I've seen many other amplifiers using this chip, and they also have given this style of operation when you turn it on. Just the first tiny bit of signal then snaps the output section into operation. So that appears to be a successful repair. Going to go ahead and case her back up and do a bench test just to make sure it's all good. Cool, time to drop a bench test then. We're all reassembled. Let's turn the power supplies on, get this thing up and running. And let's, we've got the dummy loads hooked up, so we're running a static 1 ohm load, which is for the bench test. Let's get the sine wave going here. So we've got the sine wave, and I'm just going to start slowly increasing the gain until we reach that clip point that we're looking for. There we go. So I'm going to take that as our clip point, and what I'm going to do is pause the scope screen on that wave. There we go. That's a tiny little bit of soft clip that won't be audible in the car. Yeah, let's just see what sort of power that's making. I imagine this to do a little bit overrated power with that tiny bit of soft clip there. It's a little bit more THD than I wanted, but I'm trying to do this one-handed with the camera here. So what we're going to do is, that was at about 12 volts. We're going to take 11.8. A little bit of voltage drop is what these sorts of amplifiers drop from the power supplies. We're going to say 11.8, and we're going to use square log correction factor to work out what power that did at 14.4 volts instead. So if we can see here, we've got 32.9 volts RMS that's on the sine wave. So we take our calculator here. So just out of ease for you to see, 32.9 volts into a 1 ohm load at about 11.8 volts, that made 1082 watts RMS. Not bad at all. So to work out 14.4, we do 14.4 divided by 11.8, which is about the voltage that we saw, which gives us that. Then we square the result to give us our correction factor, and we times that by the power that we saw, times by 1082.41, And so that amplifier did 1611.95 watts RMS at 14.4 with the correction factor. So yeah, that's definitely making rated power and a little bit more with a tiny bit of soft clip there. So I'm happy with that. This amplifier will now undergo a 45 minute endurance test, running some sweeps and stuff on the static 1 ohm load until I'm absolutely sure and happy that this is fully functional, and then it'll be up for sale. Thanks for watching, guys. Hope you found this useful. If you have any questions or anything, give me a shout on my BearVids Facebook page, facebook.com/BearVids. Until next time, have a good one.